So what I want to do with this video is to give you a little bit of the backdrop or pre-history leading up to the history lessons we'll be covering in the lectures to follow. In particular, we're going to be looking at events fairly deeply in the Earth's timeline, which I've represented across the top here. The present is over here on the right-hand side, and over here on the left is the start of the solar system, the start of the Earth's history, beginning right around 4.6 billion years ago. I'm sure you've seen a timeline like this. You probably have something like this in your biology text. Now, one of the things I feel is never adequately emphasized in textbooks is how dynamic a place the Earth really is. It's hugely dynamic if you look at the right time scale. By that I mean, in our familiar time scale, operating on a scale of years or decades or even centuries, the Earth's a pretty static-looking place. Mountains don't rise and fall, rivers don't change, the ocean levels really haven't budged at any noticeable level for as long as I can remember. But now, if you open things up and look over the scale of tens of millions or hundreds of millions of years, what you find is that the Earth is the total opposite of static. It's constantly on the move, and there's no place better to show this than with the movement of continents. The animation I've been playing here shows what we think are the relative position of continents on the Earth, with each frame advancing things by about 10 million years. You're probably already familiar with the concept of continental drift, and maybe you even noticed it on your own as a kid before anybody ever told you about it. Looking at a globe, it's hard to miss how South America fits so neatly into the little armpit created by Africa. In the early 1900s, Alfred Wegener was the first to take this observation and officially proposed his theory that this was a result of the movement of continents. Initially, and for the next 50-plus years, people in the scientific community scoffed at this idea. The continents were static, right? And although Wegener was pretty sure he had the right idea, his problem was that he only had the story of continental movement, and he lacked evidence. Then, in the 1960s, the evidence that Wegener really needed started to pour in. As we developed the technology to map the floor of the ocean, it became very clear that over the past 100 million years, the seafloor on the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean was showing bands of lava that were of decreasing age as you approach the center of that boundary between what we now call cratons, or plates of the Earth's crust, that are spreading apart. They're still spreading apart even today. In the time since, we've gotten pretty good at putting some real detail on the history of the continents, and this is going to be an important issue for us as we look at the major events in the evolutionary history of plants. The climate in a particular spot on the Earth is determined by a small number of drivers, that is, factors that have a predictable and profound influence on climate. Such drivers include latitude, position on the continents relative to oceans and mountain ranges, atmospheric chemistry, oceanic and atmospheric temperatures, and their circulation patterns. And as you can see on this animation, which is one of several on Professor Scotese's YouTube channel, continents move, and this movement is pretty obviously going to have a profound influence on the distribution and evolution of plants. Now, one of the things I want you to get used to doing is always demand evidence. In science, we're always trying to explain natural phenomena in a way that's supported by the available evidence. In Scotese's animation, for example, he shows that 450 million years ago, North America was sideways and much nearer to the equator. How do we know this? That's one thing to demonstrate that Africa and South America were closer together in the past, but how do you track rotational movements, clockwise versus counterclockwise, or north-south movement of the continents? I think this is a very good question to ask. Now, it turns out that the concept underlying our evidence here is relatively easy, to the point where, after learning this, you should be able to explain it to your fourth grade cousin. It has to deal with the lava that flows over the land. Other kinds of rock can be used as well, but lava is especially good because it tends to be rich in the magnetic particles, magnetite and hematite. So basically, if you have lava that's coming up from a volcanic area and it flows over the surface of the land, fluid lava is going to solidify into a flat layer that covers the surface of the Earth, right? Now, the fluid lava contains magnetite and hematite particles, which will line up in a direction that corresponds to the Earth's magnetic field. So when the lava solidified into rock, all the particles, which are effectively little compass points, will all be pointing in the same direction, dictated by the Earth's magnetic field in the place where the lava is originally solidified. So if you're at the equator and the north is over here on the left and the south is over here on the right, you know that those little particles are going to be lining up like little compass points along a horizontal line running from left to right. You could measure this easily with a magnetometer, and then we would know that this was deposited at a time when the North Pole was over here on the left and the South Pole over here, and if the rock in an area had their compass pointers pointing a different direction than the current North Pole, then we know that either the North Pole was in a different location or the land had been oriented in some rotational angle relative to its current orientation. As it turns out, North and South Poles have flipped a couple of times in the Earth's history, but other than that, there really hasn't been too much movement of the poles away from the high latitudes. That's how we recreate the rotation of the continental landmasses. The next question is, how do we know the latitude at the time of the lava flow? How do we tell if it took place closer to the equator or near to one of the poles? Well, here's where we have to look at this next image, which shows us the Earth's magnetic field. If you were to look at the arrow points here, you'd notice that the further north you go, the more vertically the arrows are pointing, such that if you're standing here on the North Pole, if you're on a boat close to the North Pole and you had a compass, the red arrow, or whichever arrow it is on the compass, it's supposed to point north, it would want to go almost straight downwards. On the South Pole, on the other hand, the north arrow would want to point straight up. So if you were to take a sample of lava rock from an area over here, say, and let's say this rock is going to be 10,000 years old, relatively measly 10,000 years old, your magnetometer would be able to tell you that the arrows, the little magnetite and hematite particles, are pointing pretty much straight north. Those are supposed to be parallel arrows. And if you were to look at a sideways direction, if you were to look at this rock when it's flat on its side, those arrows would point, this is north over here, they wouldn't be pointing straight across, they'd be pointing at a slightly downward angle, which corresponds to the fact that the Earth's magnetic field at that higher latitude is going to have a slightly downward inclination. Right? Okay, so let's look at another rock. Maybe this other rock is from over here in Nebraska. And this rock is, instead of 10,000 years, it's 450 million years old, right? So at this 450 million year old rock, what we find is that the Earth, is that the angle of the angle of inclination where the arrows are pointing is not downward, it's actually straight across. What this tells you is that back 450 million years ago, this piece of land, in fact, the entirety of the North American continent, was very close to the equator. Okay? And not only that, the arrows are not pointing straight north towards Canada. The arrows are pointing this direction, towards Japan. So what that tells you is that we can take this picture of North America and rotate it to the orientation of where it was 450 million years ago. It's kind of sideways like that. And that tells you what the rotation was. And we could also move it downwards close to the equator, and this is consistent with the information that we get from the rock, where it's showing us that the little compass points are perfectly horizontal with no inclination at all. These are the kind of data that are used to recreate the positions of the continents in the past, like what we saw with that earlier Scotese animation. Now, I think this is really great. It's a good example of how we can use evidence presented by the natural world to reconstruct the past in deep time. Now, although the concept here is relatively straightforward, as I said before, you should be able to explain this to your fourth grade cousin. In order to get enough information to generate the kind of reconstruction in Scotese's animation, well, that's a whole different story. You have to go out to countless sites around the world, collect thousands and thousands of samples of rock, and carefully document things like what plane was horizontal at the time of the deposition of the rock and what compass direction the rock sample was oriented at when you took the sample. Then back in your lab, you have to record the magnetic orientation of the particles in the rock and then corroborate the thousands of data points to produce what will ultimately be an imperfect narrative of the geographical history of the Earth over the course of billions of years. This is an enormous undertaking, driven partly by curiosity, but in the end it may also be highly informative and practical for humans as we continue to seek mineral resources in the future. Most of the big metal deposits, like nickel and copper and gold, were formed in geologic processes of the deep, deep past, and therefore knowledge of these continental movements and activities will be useful for locating such resources into the future. But there's another part to understanding the evidence, and I'm hoping that you might have asked it silently to yourself already. And this has to deal with, how do we know how old the rock was? I mean, we could have this piece of rock right here, right? And you can say, sure, Jeff, I totally understand why this rock had to have been at this particular latitude, given the angle of inclination of the hematite particles in the rock. But how do we know it's that old? You say it's from 450 million years ago. How do I know you're right? Because if you don't know how old the rock is, then there'd be no way for you to tell how long ago the continent was in this latitude or that rotational position. And I want to start off by saying this is basically a very different question. And we're going to have to use a different methodology called radiometric dating. And this is really, really neat. I think that this may be very well beyond the scope of your fourth grade cousin, but if he has a sister in the 10th grade, now a 10th grader might be taking chemistry, and she'd be familiar with the periodic table of elements. And so she'd know, for example, that K is a symbol for potassium, and AR as a symbol for argon. And maybe you're familiar enough with these elements such that we can actually talk about things like potassium-argon dating. Now, as a 10th grade chemistry student would know, argon is a gas, whereas potassium is just like a regular non-gas element that will be there in various kinds of minerals. And so in brand new lava rock, rock that is just solidified, you would have a starting content of potassium, but the argon content will initially be exactly equal to zero, because when lava is liquid, all that gas will outgassed. We would have the total outgassing of all the argon content before the lava solidifies. Now, a known proportion of the potassium content will be potassium 40. Okay? That's the variation or isotope of potassium in which you have 40 neutrons and protons total. The particles in the nucleus are 40 in total. And this is an unstable isotope, that will undergo this process of radioactive decay. Right, so this declining curve like this kind of depicts the decline of a radioactive substance over time. And what happens is that you might have 100 grams of potassium-40 initially. After one half-life, after exactly one half-life, the potassium-40 content will decline by 50%. After another half-life, the potassium-40 will have declined by another 50%, or you'd have about 1/4 of the total remaining potassium-40. Now, as this is going on, the potassium-40 is declining, and the argon-40, which is the product of the radioactive decay, never mind how it actually forms, but it's a product that is initially there in zero concentration, it's going to start to increase. It's going to increase. The argon gets trapped in the crystalline structure of the rock. And so, if you have a sample of rock, by knowing how much potassium-40 there was to start with, which would be a known proportion of the total potassium content of the rock, and how much argon has accumulated in the rock since it solidified, you can tell how long ago it was that the lava solidified into rock. Now, in order to test the age of the rock, you need some basic equipment. You need to be able to measure the potassium content and also the argon content of your rock sample. Now, if you think about it, this allows you to do some really cool stuff. Go back down here to this picture, right? Get rid of my little arrows. And so this method allows us to precisely determine the age of volcanic layers and also the age ranges of sedimentary layers that might be there in between volcanic flows. It doesn't have to be lava, it can be volcanic ash as well. But let's use lava as an example. So let's say we had this lava flow 450 million years ago, and then Over time, basically, it sunk down to the bottom of the ocean, and we had some sediments depositing over lava. Okay? So we get sediments depositing, and then at a later point, we have a reactivation of the lava flows, and lava starts to come to the surface again, and we end up having a flow of lava on top of this. Now, when this top layer of lava rock solidifies, it's going to be younger in age relative to the 450 million year old lava that we have down here below. Okay, maybe the top layer is going to be 410 million years old when we eventually get around to measuring its potassium argon content. By doing this, we can say that this layer of sediment, all these fossils and these sediments in between, are going to be somewhere between 410 and 450 million years old. Okay. So this is actually a really good method that we can use to confidently place how old fossil-bearing shales are because of the presence of volcanic layers, volcanic ash, and lava rock that sandwich sedimentary layers in between them. Now, in recent years, we have developed some ridiculously cool general climate models that run on massive computers that use data from oceanic and atmospheric circulation, temperature, and a whole bunch of other stuff. So we are able to take all this information and use it to model climate. And one of the things we can do with this is to predict the weather way, way better than was possible, say, 20 years ago. Now, you might complain if the weather app on your phone is not always exactly right. Maybe it starts raining at 10 p.m. rather than midnight. But it wasn't that long ago that we used to make fun of the weather forecasters on the news for being right only about half the time, which is pretty hard here in Southern California, where it's sunny 8 days out of 10. But just the fact that no one makes jokes about the news weather reporters anymore says a lot about the quality of the weather models that we're using. Now, these weather models are just part of a larger and more general set of Earth system models for climate, taking into consideration a lot of things like changes in solar and cosmic energy flux, atmospheric composition, how much carbon dioxide, how much oxygen there is in the atmosphere, land surface, air and sea temperatures at different elevations and depths, and also the continental positions. Now, these are the same models that allow us to project the effects of various scenarios of change in human behavior and activity. Like, what's going to happen? How much is it going to warm if we were to reduce our carbon emissions by X percent? Right? How long will it take for us to reach 2 degrees Celsius increase if we don't change our carbon emissions at all? Now, there's a lot at stake, and we're heavily invested in having the best possible models available. Well, it's these same cutting-edge models that have given us much, much more insight to the paleoecological conditions in different parts of the world and at different points in the past. Now remember, climatic conditions are perhaps the biggest factors in determining the kind of plant life that's going to be supported in a given area. Plant life, as we'll see in coming lectures, can take on an important role in affecting climate. And these two factors, the plant life and the physical environment that both determines and is influenced by the plant life, are what defines the ecosystem much more so than the animals that are supported by the plants. To summarize, I have described three kinds of evidence or inference that can be used to reconstruct the Earth's past. The first one was paleomagnetism, and we use this to infer the configurations of the continents over the Earth's history. We talked about radiometric dating, and specifically potassium argon dating, which is widely used in determining the ages of fossils. We also talked about these general circulation models, or Earth system models, which are really important in allowing us to recreate global climate, and actually specific local climates as well, at different times in the Earth's past. I put this lesson together as an introduction to the approach that we'll be taking in this video series, in particular emphasizing paleoecology and its impact on plant evolution. Now, from this point, we're going to move on to actually discussing that timeline that I had up at the beginning, building towards and ultimately talking about the origin of land plants.